You might assume that measuring distance would be simple because it relies on GPS, but even this is prone to error. A study published in 2020 comparing a range of smartwatches, other activity trackers, and smartphones showed that the median error rates were between 0.6 and 1.5%, with turns and hilly segments being linked with greater error. But now, companies like Garmin have started to use multiple satellite or multiband frequencies in their newest smartwatches. With multiple satellite frequencies, the receiver can use more advanced methods to determine which signals have less error, thus improving position accuracy. The net result for tracking your running is better accuracy in more challenging environments, like when the signals are being reflected off buildings or in cases where the signal is blocked under trees, for example. The measurement of heart rate involves the use of photoplethysmography, or optical blood flow sensing. Photoplethysmography sensors use an optical probe, usually LEDs, to shine light directly into the skin and the underlying blood vessels. Like the measurement of distance, the accuracy of heart rate measurement is improving with the development of better optical sensors and as algorithms become more refined. For heart rate sensors like those typically found in wrist-worn wearables, studies evaluating accuracy compared with the gold standard of a chest-worn heart rate monitor have found errors of between 1.4 and 13%. Errors are worse for certain types of exercises, for instance, calisthenic or bodyweight exercises, and in certain conditions, like when it's cold. Energy expenditure is particularly tricky to measure using wearables. A systematic review and meta-analysis published in 2020 found error rates to be high. For instance, depending on the device, energy expenditure was underestimated by over 20% and overestimated by nearly 15%. The authors did, however, find that accuracy improved for devices that combined more inputs. Devices that relied on accelerometry alone were prone to higher error compared with those that also used heart rate, for example.
One of the most interesting variables to runners, and probably the next most commonly measured variable by the latest crop of running watches, aside from distance, heart rate, and energy expenditure, is aerobic capacity, or VO2 max.
VO2 max is normally measured in a laboratory setting through a maximal running test. A person's VO2 max can be determined directly as they breathe through a mask while completing an incremental test to voluntary failure. Obviously, wearables don't have the capacity to replicate this test, so they use algorithms to predict what a person's VO2 max is. It depends on what algorithm is being used, but errors can be up to 5%. For someone with a predicted VO2 max of 50 milliliters of oxygen per kilogram of mass per minute, their true value could be anywhere between 47.5 and 52.5.
Lactate threshold, like VO2 max, can be estimated using a combination of heart rate and pace data.
In the lab, lactate threshold is measured by drawing blood at intervals during an incremental test to directly measure the buildup of lactate. No commercially available wearables can directly measure lactate threshold yet, but estimates can be made using heart rate, pace, and VO2 max data. Data evaluating the accuracy of these estimates is hard to come by. But one conference paper published in 2021, which used the Garmin Fenix 6, significantly underestimated the speed at which lactate accumulation occurred by 10.4%. As with VO2 max and lactate thresholds, the gold standard approach to evaluating biomechanics of running necessitates a visit to the research lab. Participants will generally be instrumented with a set of reflective markers and asked to run either on a treadmill or over a surface incorporating a stationary force plate.
But unlike VO2 max and lactate threshold, the gold standard here is not exactly flawless. The trouble is that the data lab protocols produce tends to lack generalizability because they do not exactly replicate running in the real world. In contrast, wearable sensors that contain accelerometers and gyroscopes have the potential to collect biomechanical data from runners in their natural environment.
Wrist-worn wearables and those placed on the foot have been used to estimate spatiotemporal variables like the number of steps you take per minute, otherwise known as your cadence, your step and stride lengths, and your vertical oscillation. A new metric that has been marketed to runners over the last 5 years is running power, which is measured in watts. Cyclists have been using power for many years as a way to produce consistent performance in both training and racing. But power has taken a while to make its way to running because, unlike cycling where power can be measured directly, during running there are far more biomechanical and situational variables that make it much harder to generate accurate and useful data. That said, it may be a useful adjunct to more traditional measures like pace and heart rate. Theoretically, power tracks the actual work output of every step rather than your heart's response or the pace that results from that work. For example, if you decided to base your training on your speed or heart rate, aiming for specific heart rate zones or lap times, factors like heat or altitude can increase your heart rate relative to your pace. In contrast, power is a great equalizer as it reflects the output of your muscles rather than the environment they and the rest of your body is working in.
The primary issue with wearables in running contexts today is that very few of the metrics they tout will actually improve your performance or make you run a better race. None have been validated independently. The companies selling these products tend to deliver well-crafted pitches about their product, about how it can make you a better or a faster runner. But generally, they fail to back up their claims with large longitudinal, independently gathered data sets.